Everything is good. It's gonna be a long day for you all, though.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we'll see. I think we'll be here till 7-ish. And by 7-ish, that could go up to 7:59. We could go past it, so. So we'll see.
And be like the old days.
It is like the old days. I feel very, like, buckled in for whatever, so.
Which I didn't know that used to. So I got here during COVID.
I know.
Yesterday.
You never even had a...
Wait, why is this thing at 5:30? And they were like, oh, that's how it used to be.
There was a good night's sleep. We're here, so.
How can we pull the camera?
Brenwyn, here. Jalali?
Here.
Baker? Prince?
Here.
Tao?
Here.
Tolbert?
Here.
Five present, two absent. Commissioners Yang and Nager are excused. Item number one, Min 22-20, approving the minutes of the June 2022 HRE meetings.
Thank you. And maybe before we vote on this, just some general housekeeping. I know that there are issues with Legistar that we've had our contractor knows about it, and we're trying to resolve that. I was told if you go to the meeting, is it meeting minutes?
Details.
Meeting details, you can individually click on any of the agenda items that are on there, and I have all the attachments. So it's a one extra step, but anybody who's watching this and wants to look at it, that's the way to view it. But we will have it fixed and eventually and put up normally. So just want to flag that. We do have approval of minutes before us, and I'll take a motion from Commissioner Tao. All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? The motion passes.
Five in favor, no one opposed. The minutes are approved. Item number two, Resolution 22-1068, approving and authorizing a temporary license agreement with 11 Wells Spirits Company, LLC, for an initial term of 6 months to use a portion of HRA-owned property located at 694 Minnehaha Avenue East, District 4, Ward 7.
Director Goodman.
Thank you, Chair Tolbert. Commissioners, as mentioned, this is a temporary license agreement with 11 Wells Spirits. It's for just a small portion of HRA-owned land there at their location on the Ham site. They would be using it for loading, parking, customer seating, and general business operations. And it does include the option to renew the temporary license agreement at the end of that term for an additional 6 months. Those allowed uses would be subject to any relevant approvals, permits, or licenses. And this is in addition to an existing access easement recorded on this area of the land for pedestrian and emergency and non-emergency vehicle access. So just for them to be able to use it as a patio and some additional uses, and staff does recommend approval of the item.
Any comments or questions? If not, a motion to approve by Commissioner Prince. Roll call. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The motion passes.
Five in favor, none opposed. The resolution is adopted. Item number three, Resolution 22-1069, approving and authorizing a temporary license agreement with Flat Earth Holdings, LLC, DBA St. Paul Brewing, until October 31st, 2022, to use a portion of HRA-owned property located at 694 Minnehaha Avenue East, District 4, Ward 7.
Director Gooden.
Thank you, Chair Tolbert. Commissioners, very similar item. Temporary license agreement, not quite for as long of a term, through October 31st, with the option to extend for an additional 30 days. Additional space beyond what they're currently using for seating and serving and temporary furniture as needed to operate the patio. Again, subject to any relevant approvals, permits, or licenses, and staff recommends approval of the item.
Any comments or questions? If not, a motion to approve by Commissioner Prince. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? The motion passes.
Five in favor, none opposed. The resolution is adopted. Item number four, Resolution 22-1070, authorizing and approving a loan of up to $1,500,000 in home funds, authorizing and approving the removal of an approved $200,000 CDBG loan, and authorization to enter into a home loan agreement with the execution of other related documents for the Stryker Senior Housing Project, District 3, Ward 2.
Director Gooden.
Thank you, Chair Tolbert. Commissioners, Principal Project Manager Dan Bayers is here today to provide a staff report on this item. You may not recognize him without his big COVID beard, but this that's actually him.
I did a double take.
Mr. Bayers, welcome.
Chair Tolbert, Commissioners, Dan Bayers, PED. In front of you today is, we're bringing back the Stryker Senior Housing Project that the board approved back in October of last year. The change that is different from the approval from October 2021 is that we're going to be removing some of the CDBG funds and including additional $750,000 in home funds for a total of $1,500,000. And the main reason for this change is, well, there's two things. One is the cost of the construction for this project has been increasing about 11%. That's mainly just the construction cost for this project. And second of all, the reason we're removing the CDBG funds and inserting the home funds is that NIDA is a sole member of the Stryker Senior Housing LLC, is a CHODO, Community Housing Development Organization. There's only two in the city of St. Paul. And home funds do have funds set aside for CHODO developers, and so we're going to use those funds to help with this project. So there's kind of two reasons why we're switching out those funds. I can go more into the detail of the project if you like about how many units and who it's affordable, but it's mainly an affordable senior housing project. It has mostly 30%, 50% units. There will be VASH units, so it's going to be VASH stands for Veteran Assistance, and so we'll be assisting veteran housing. The other day, Ramsey County awarded some ARPA funds, so there are going to be additional 30% units in there. So this is really a low, affordable housing, senior housing development.
Any questions or comments? All right. Thank you very much. If not, a motion to approve by Commissioner Brenmoan. All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? The motion passes.
5 in favor, none opposed. The resolution is adopted. Item number 5, Resolution 22-1072, approving key terms of the Inspiring Communities Home Ownership Program Manual and Inspiring Communities RFP scoring criteria, approving and authorizing the HRA to participate in the Minnesota Housing Finance Agency Community Homeownership Impact Fund, and to accept funding and establish a budget of $1,067,400 for redevelopment, rescinding Resolution 16-1190, approving and authorizing amendment of the Housing Trust Fund budget to include an additional $2 million for the Inspiring Communities Program citywide.
All right. Director Goodman.
Thank you, Chair Tolbert. Commissioners, that was a long title, Tina. Senior Project Manager Nick Betcher is here today to provide a staff report on this item.
Good afternoon, Chair Tolbert, members of the board. Am I in the right spot? It's been
right in the middle.
It's been a long time. My name is Nick Betcher. I'm a senior project manager on the housing team at PED. My work focuses primarily on single family and homeownership housing development and policy, including the city's and HRA's Inspiring Communities program. Happy to be here today and extend my thanks as well to my PED colleagues, Joe Musolf, Marian Abdi, Michael Wade, Sarah Zorn, Luke Aldenthal, Kurt Schultz, Housing Director Beard, Director Goodman, former staff and leadership, including Dion Garamu-Nuramachi, Kayla Schuckman and Kristen Guild, Adam Niblick with the City Attorney's Office, as well as Sarah Schwartzoff, and our partners at HUD, the Met Council, Minnesota Housing, and the Family Housing Fund. I also want to thank our nonprofit housing community, and in particular, NeighborWorks Home Partners, Neighborhood Development Alliance, Dayton's Bluff NHS, and the Rondo Community Land Trust, whose expertise and patience has been immeasurable and who deserve thanks for delivering for our community. All of them, as well as each of you members of the board, deserve credit for the achievements of the Inspiring Communities program over the past 9 years and for getting us to where we are today, which is updating the program to respond to new conditions and new challenges and providing much needed capital and spending authorization to continue this important work. Inspiring Communities is the city's primary vehicle for redeveloping small properties owned by the city or the HRA for affordable housing, and particularly affordable owner-occupied housing. This program leverages HRA property to build community wealth, creates job opportunities for local residents, including small and emerging businesses, and businesses owned by women and people of color, and inspires innovative and environmentally sound design and construction. This redevelopment returns vacant city and HRA-owned property to productive use, adding housing stock, increasing tax revenues, and reducing maintenance costs to the public. Over the 9 years of the program, staff has published 6 RFP and overseen redevelopment of more than 290 properties. This has resulted in affordable homes for approximately 150 homeowner families of color and 40 renter families of color. Staff is now preparing to launch a 7th RFP to make available 12 HRA-owned properties, which will add between 13 and 20 housing units. As you'll be able to see on the list and the map attached to today's agenda and board report, 2 of these properties are in the North End, 3 in Railroad Island, 3 are to the northeast in Payne-Phelan, 3 are in Dayton's Bluff, and 1 is on the west side. These neighborhoods are home to a large share of properties improved through the Inspiring Communities program to date, though I should note that the west side, Frogtown, Summit University, and West 7th are underrepresented in RFP 7 and have also seen a significant number of Inspiring Communities projects of their own since the inception of the program. The 12 RFP 7 properties identified have been prioritized for redevelopment because they're subject to federal funding deadlines and are free of factors that would excessively complicate redevelopment. Still, roughly half of these sites are what would be considered undersized for construction of a typical single-family detached home with a garage, and may take some ingenuity on the part of developers. In preparation for this RFP, staff has reviewed key terms of the program, which hasn't seen a significant update in 6 years, in response to market conditions and evolving public policy. We're prepared to request your approval today of key terms of the Inspiring Communities Homeownership Program Manual, which, along with adjustments to RFP scoring criteria, I'll now summarize for you. First, recall that the program provides two types of subsidy on homeownership projects. The first and the largest is a development subsidy that covers a gap between the developer's total development costs and the market value of the property upon completion. The second is assistance to the home buyer, which in small amounts provides an incentive or a cushion, and in larger amounts can significantly improve affordability and bring the home's purchase price within reach to lower income households. It fills a gap between what the homeowner can afford, usually a first mortgage, some cash, and perhaps other down payment assistance, and their cost to purchase the property for market value. The development subsidy has for several years been kept at $175,000. You may recall that recently staff has brought a number of requests to this board to request a waiver of that subsidy on a project-by-project basis. We've heard from you an interest in greater flexibility under this cap and propose both to raise this cap to $200,000 and to provide limited discretion at the level of the executive director or their designee to consider and approve or reject modest increases in project budgets. Program-level spending authority, of course, still will lie with this board. Details on this proposal are found in the board report. Passage of this motion today will render a previous board action, Resolution 16-1190, obsolete because it addressed only the subsidy cap, and we therefore recommend that it be rescinded. As to homebuyer assistance, we wish to honor a sincerely expressed aim of this board and many others to serve lower-income households. We recognize that households of color are overrepresented among lower-income households, and these households face the greatest challenges to attaining and keeping affordable housing. In prior RFP, sales of homes were generally limited to households with incomes at or below 120% or 115% of the Twin Cities area median. For RFP 7, we propose a general limit of 80% AMI. To achieve this, particularly in this time of fairly high housing prices and rising interest rates, and while encouraging construction of two-unit properties, will require more funding for homebuyer assistance than the program has traditionally provided. Accordingly, we propose raising the amount of homebuyer assistance available from $5,000 to $40,000 for single-unit properties, and to $90,000 for two-unit properties. Once the RFP is published, and we aim for release yet this summer with no exact date yet determined, staff will evaluate proposals according to scoring criteria. As in the past, proposals will be evaluated in terms of their cost reasonableness and level of financial assistance requested, use of innovative designs, construction methods, and materials, and a commitment to deliver on the city's goal of achieving equity, or a state where all residents, regardless of race, gender, disability, or socioeconomic background, have an equitable opportunity to win contracts, secure job opportunities, and find affordable housing. For RFP 7, as compared to prior RFP, equity is centered. Criteria pertinent to equity will comprise roughly 3/4 of the total points available in the proposal rating system. This is an increase from RFP 6, when it accounted for just over half of available points. We'll consider equity on two fronts, contracting and workforce equity and housing equity. Within contracting and workforce equity, our RFP scoring criteria encourage and incentivize new and emerging developers, particularly those who have participated in the city's emerging and BIPOC developer initiative or other similar programs, who are recognized through the CERT program as, for example, an emerging small business enterprise or woman or BIPOC-owned business, or recruit workers from local communities. New for this RFP 7 are incentives for developers who partner with general contractors and marketing agents that are CERT businesses or Section 3 residents. Within housing equity, developers are incentivized to serve households at levels lower than 80% AMI to engage first-generation buyers, to build larger units suitable to larger families, and to ensure income restrictions on second housing units in addition to the primary housing unit. Staff anticipate the RFP will be open for at least 2 months to allow adequate time for new and emerging developers to respond. We'll be back before this board with recommendations as to which proposals to accept. Staff has made successful application to the Minnesota Housing Finance Agency's Community Homeownership Impact Fund and the city's own CDBG finance capital improvement budget process, receiving allocations combined of just over $1.6 million. We propose making use of another $300,000 currently unreserved from the Housing Trust Fund, which is dedicated to community land trust projects, should we receive any community land trust proposals through this RFP. And request today an additional $2 million from the Housing Trust Fund to support the Inspiring Communities program. Underpinning our cost estimates is a presumption that the City Council will pass a resolution next week authorizing non-use of project labor agreements on pending single-family housing projects. While we understand that the City Council has regularly passed similar resolutions for parks and public works projects, this is the first request PED has brought to the City Council of this nature. We recognize that the 2009 resolution establishing PLA requirements is ill-suited to construction of 1-to-4-unit properties on scattered sites. We suspect it was not designed with these types of projects in mind, and if its $250,000 threshold had kept pace with inflation in the construction industry, it'd now be over $410,000. On PED's quite large housing projects, like the Stryker Senior Housing Project or 1222 University, project labor agreements are routinely made between developers and unions. Residential building contractors licensed to work on 1-to-4-unit owner projects are licensed separately by the state from commercial builders that work on large projects, including multifamily projects. It's common to find small family businesses on single-family construction sites. They and the small and emerging businesses we're eager to engage are not well positioned to deliver under project labor agreements and would likely be dissuaded from bidding should single-family housing projects be subject to PLA. Our own experience with nearly 300 Inspiring Communities homes to date illustrates that these projects can be completed successfully without project labor agreements, and we recommend that the City Council pass the resolution authorizing non-use of PLA when it arrives for a vote next week. Finally, back to the long title of the resolution. Staff requests that this HRA board pass the resolution before it today, approving key terms of the Inspiring Communities Homeownership Program Manual and Inspiring Communities RFP scoring criteria, approving and authorizing the HRA to participate in the MHFA Community Homeownership Impact Fund, and to accept funding and establish a budget of $1,067,400 for redevelopment, rescinding Resolution 16-1190, and approving and authorizing amendment of the Housing Trust Fund budget to include an additional $2 million for the Inspiring Communities program. With that, I conclude my remarks and welcome your questions and comments.
Any questions or comments? Commissioner Prince?
I think the only one is, and you said that it would be, that it, you didn't have a specific date for the RFP, but I wondered if we have a rough idea. And I just wanted to ask that we be notified so we can get the word out to developers that we're aware of for whom this would be.
Yeah, I'll have to regroup with my bosses and staff and make sure we've got a solid plan to deliver on a specific date and get that information out to you, and we'll get it on our website as well.
And I also just want to say this is really great work and really good news for getting people into affordable home ownership.
Commissioner Bremer?
I appreciate that you started out recognizing the work that has gone into this project from the get-go. It has been, I think, a very, very successful program, and it took a team to get it to the place it is today. With construction costs up and the remaining lots being our most challenging lots, I'm not the least bit surprised to have this come before us. I'm very supportive. I'm also supportive of the notion that we don't want to send people back to the drawing board for a modest adjustment. I know that we've had a few contracts that took a while to get out, and by the time they got out, the cost of the bid went up a little bit, and it's in order to, for them to start all the way over from the beginning of the process is not efficient, and oftentimes means that a project just won't get done. So I support that as well. And I appreciate the work putting this together. And I would just add that we remain in control of several splinter lots or unbuildable parcels. And I do encourage us as the HRA and as a PED to make a plan to shed the properties that we aren't going to be using for this program. And particularly looking, if it's a splinter parcel or an unbuildable parcel, particularly in one of our concentrated areas of poverty, to look at adding those to the lot next to them, as opposed to trying to stuff more housing into already dense areas. I think that we should be focusing our ADUs and our small, tiny homes in areas that are thriving, and giving a little breathing room in areas where there's more challenges. I know sometimes the lots in areas I represent are 25 feet across, and so getting the lot next to them can be a deal changer. But I know we're holding on to a few parcels and still not collecting any sort of property taxes on them, and still responsible for their maintenance and upkeep. So as long as those are on the list, I think that we have a responsibility to find an owner for them, that if we're not going to be intentionally building on them. So I'd encourage us to keep moving on that as well.
Great. Thank you. Any other comments or questions? Not, thank you for all your work on this. Appreciate it. Very thorough presentation.
Thank you.
Now we can take a motion to approve this by Commissioner Jalali. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? The motion passes.
Five in favor, none opposed. The resolution is adopted.
That brings us to the end of the meeting. Anything else? If not, like I said, the legislature will be updated once our vendor fixes it. So. Thank you to all your staff and all the work today. We are adjourned.